So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Benoit Antoine Bacon, our provost. He needs no great introduction to our local community. We've been talking about trade in the last 24 hours, courtesy of Bob Wolf's trade policy. And the provost, I think, is an expert at trade negotiations with his deans and trade unions. And with that, I'll sit down. Benoit.
Good evening. It's such a pleasure to be here. Thank you, David, for inviting me. Thank you, Robert, for inviting me. Thank you, everybody, for being here. I would like to start by offering to Ms. Gonzalez and to all of you the following greetings from our principal, Daniel Wolf, who's on his way to India because he understands the importance of internationalization and trade. Daniel says, good evening. Thank you for attending this year's J. Douglas Gibson Lecture at Queen's University. It is with regret that I cannot join you in person this evening. I have no doubt that this will be an informative and inspiring lecture, given Ms. Gonzalez's extensive expertise and career achievements in international trade and economics. On behalf of the university, I thank her for sharing her knowledge with the Queen's community. Best wishes, Principal and Vice Chancellor Daniel Wolf. And I now join my own voice to the principal to welcome you here at the J. Douglas Gibson Lecture, to be given this year by Arantxa Gonzalez, the Executive Director, International Trade Center in Geneva. The J. Douglas Gibson Lecture Series was established in 1988 by the family and friends to honor the memory of Mr. J. Douglas Gibson, Chairman of Queen's University's Board of Trustees from 69 to 75. For 34 years, Mr. Gibson worked for the Bank of Nova Scotia in various capacities, including Assistant General Manager, Deputy Chairman, and Executive Vice President. He had a long interest in questions of international affairs, public finance, and taxation. The Gibson Lecture brings to Queen's University each year an internationally renowned scholar or public figure to deliver a public lecture on a topic relevant to the mandate of the School of Policy Studies. I would like to express my deep appreciation to the family and friends of J. Douglas Gibson for honoring his memory in this way. We're very fortunate to have tonight the Executive Director of the International Trade Center, Arantxa Gonzalez. She heads a unique organization in the United Nations system. The ITC is the Joint Cooperation Agency of the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development and of the World Trade Organization. Arantxa Gonzalez holds a degree in law from the University of Navarra and a postgraduate degree in European law from the University of Carlos III, Madrid. Before joining ITC, Ms. Gonzalez served as Chief of Staff to World Trade Organization Director General Pascal Lamy from 2005 to 2013. Prior to working at the WTO, Ms. Gonzalez held several positions at the European Commission, the executive body of the European Union. She was involved in conducting negotiations of trade agreements and assisting developing countries in trade developing efforts. Is globalization worth saving? Is the timely and tantalizing title of the talk. Please join me in welcoming the Executive Director of the International Trade Center, Ms. Arantxa Gonzalez.
Thank you so much for inviting me to deliver this speech in Queen's University. And thank you for suggesting a theme that is both relevant but also important for the future, not only of our economies but of our societies. Globalization is a term that is so overused that sometimes I feel is a bit devoid of meaning, especially these days. But one thing is clear today is cross-border flows of goods, of services, of capital, of people, of technology, and even ideas have never been as controversial as they are today. Especially, they've never been as controversial as since the fall of the Berlin Wall back in 1989. In the United States, you know this well because they are your neighbor. One candidate is vowing to tear up trade deals and to slap Chinese goods with tariffs. and to build a wall with the Mexican border, but they are not the only ones. At the opposite end of the political spectrum, millions of Americans were thrilled by a very different vision for resolving the economic woes of the poor and the middle classes, a vision that nevertheless regarded trade agreements and deals such as NAFTA or the Trans-Pacific Partnership, they view them with similar disdain. Across the Atlantic, in the United Kingdom, in June, they took a decision to secede from the European Union, as a majority of voters were convinced by calls to take back control from migrants, from trade, or from regulatory policies set by the supranational institutions in Brussels. From Finland to France, from Denmark to Hungary, and even today in Germany, your skeptic parties are on the rise. And what they have in common is their contempt, not just for immigrants or refugees, but also for globalism that they cast in opposition to the nation state. Mainstream parties, too, have become less enthusiastic about trade and investment, and you probably have heard about the travails of the European-Canada trade agreement, CETA, so I need not go in depth into that subject. Similarly, a trade deal between the European Union and the United States, the so-called TTIP, has for now been put on hold. Now, back in 1748, Montesquieu, I love Montesquieu, promised us that commerce cured the most destructive prejudices, and that wherever there is commerce, we meet with agreeable manners. And for most of the post-1945 era, thus was the case. Now, what went wrong? If we look back to the turn of the century, a backlash against globalization was not difficult to imagine. The World Trade Organization, Seattle's conference, had just ended in chaos in the street, and North and South discord in ministerial meeting rooms. Financial crises were reverberating from Thailand to Russia to Argentina, and yet, the arrow pointed more to the heart of the open global order, not from Asia, not from Africa, not from Latin America, but mostly from the electorate in the United States. I have started to spell out why globalization might need saving. But this talk is not about why and whether it may need saving, but rather whether it is worth saving. And I'm going to argue that it is, and that the case is so straightforward that it can be summed up only in 15 words. We live in the era of Twitter, so we've got to make our thoughts very clear in very few words. 15 words are my favorite words. But before we do that, I want to take a poll in this room. I want to ask a question. And I'm going to propose you 5 answers. And I'm going to ask you to choose your favorite answer. I did this test this morning already with a group of students, so let's see whether the result is different here. How many of you think that the share of the global population that lives in extreme poverty has over the past 20 years increased by 50% or more? Nobody. How many of you think that that proportion has increased by 20% or more? Nobody. How many of you think that it has stayed around the same? One gentleman. How about two? How about a 25% decrease in the share of people living in extreme poverty in the last 20 years? Okay, big amount of hands. And finally, who thinks there has been more than 50% decrease? The actual figure, a 67% decrease. In the last 20 years, extreme poverty has decreased. The share of population living in extreme poverty has decreased by 67%. The share of humans living in extreme poverty has declined by two-thirds over the last 20 years. Within my lifetime, extreme poverty was seen as a scourge that would be with us forever. And today, just last year, the United Nations, the family of the United Nations, under the United Nations Global Goals, agreed to eradicate extreme poverty by 2030. So what we're talking about is a world with no extreme poverty by 2030. And this brings me to my 15 words, elevator pitch for why globalization is worth saving. Because the open global economy has helped lift over a billion people out of extreme poverty. And this will be my reason why keeping this open system is important. It's not only necessary, but it's worth doing. I will substantiate these arguments, and I will also address why something so positive is, in some circles, so unpopular. In doing so, I will focus primarily on trade and investment, essentially for three reasons. One, because trade and investment is subject to internationally agreed set of rules, because it is governed by agreements, because it is governed by law. Two, because the organization that I head, the International Trade Center, does precisely this: help developing countries, help small and medium enterprises participate in international trade and investment. And three, because trade and investment has been central to the fast growth that has reduced poverty sharply across this large masses of population around the developing world, and in particular in a country called China. As I do so, I want to make very clear that an essential component of this globalization is technology, which is very much here to stay and who is responsible for an incredible pace of economic and societal change. Now, let's examine this last point. Think about what a developing economy looks like. Lots of people in low productivity activities like subsistence agriculture or petty services and a huge informal sector. This is what a developing economy looks like. A critical part of the development process is what economists call structural transformation. Essentially, getting people and resources out of subsistence work and into more productive activities. Trade comes in here because in developing countries, international tradable sectors tend to be more productive than the rest of the economy. And as a result, getting people and capital out of non-tradable sectors and into firms dealing in tradable goods and services makes for a more productive economy overall. Predictably, open global markets make it possible, stress possible, for countries to hitch their wagon to the world economy and use this world economy to drive the structural transformation process. Imagine what would have happened if trading partners slammed the door, the second influential sections of domestic industry started to get nervous about competition from the West, be it Germany, Japan, Korea, or China. First, we would not have seen a growth miracle, and we certainly would have seen a much slower poverty reduction. And second, the money in your pocket would go to a lot less, because everything from cars to socks to phones would cost substantially more. So trade agreements, starting with the GATT-WTO system, are fundamentally about keeping markets predictably open. They are about governments setting clear rules of the game and working together to identify and discipline policies that impose negative externalities on trading partners. A Canadian economist, Brian McCaig, has looked at what happened in Vietnam after 2001. In 2001, a bilateral trade deal with Washington meant that the US cut tariffs on textiles and garments from Vietnam. In 3 years after the agreement, which paved Vietnam's accession to the World Trade Organization, Vietnamese clothing exports to the US nearly quadrupled. Poverty rates fell twice as fast in the 4 years leading up to 2001. 7 million people were lifted out of poverty. A relatively modest number of new export-oriented factory jobs, around 250,000, stimulated the creation of many other jobs with ripple effects felt as higher productivity on farms, for example, as they adapted to less labor. So that is how trade contributed to the structural transformation of a country called Vietnam. But Vietnam is not the only one. There are thousands of Vietnam in this world. Nobel-winning economist Michael Spence, the economist who headed the Commission on Growth and Development, he looked at countries' post-war growth record. And he found that the countries that managed to sustain high growth for a long period of time had all made active use of the world economy as a source of both demand and know-how. In their phrase, in the phrase of Michael Spence and his commission, these countries imported what the world knew and exported what the world wanted. Both sides of the equation are important. It's about value addition and it's about diversification. And the two are needed to sustain growth through the commodity price downturns that are a fact of life, as Canadians know too well. It is a fact that countries and communities that have been most marginal in international trade and investment or connected only as suppliers of raw materials present today much more challenging development challenges. So there is a correlation between participating in international trade, a positive correlation, and progress on health, on education, and on reducing inequality. Now, I hope I've started to convince you that globalization is worth saving. Now, the question we need to ask ourselves now is how we are going to do that. And here I want to talk a little bit about Canada. Not because I want to flatter a Canadian audience, you're all really super nice, but I think it turns out that Canada offers a few lessons for those wanting to manage this globalization process in a more inclusive manner. Think back of the dismal picture of politics in many advanced economies that I drew at the beginning of the speech, and think now about Canada and Prime Minister Justin Trudeau's advocacy for the merits of open societies. To be sure, those beliefs, I'm sure, are not universally shared in this country. Many Canadians think that an open hand is the best way to help newcomers integrate. Others disagree. As a matter of fact, it's probably this country that has produced the sharpest critics of the rights that NAFTA and similar accords give to private investors to sue governments over regulatory measures. And we had a little bit of that in conversations that I held today at Queen's. In the 1988 election, more than half of Canadian voters voted for parties opposed to a new free trade agreement with the US. Even if the vagaries of the electoral system meant that Brian Mulroney's FTA supporting conservatives carried the day, but there was also a sizable opposition to that agreement. A generation on, however, I think Canadians know that the first deep integration agreement with the US didn't wipe out the border. That NAFTA didn't wipe out the border. That Medicare hasn't vanished. That water has not been piped across the 49th parallel as Canadians watched helplessly. These were some of the considerations that were very high at the time. In fact, surveys suggest that for much of the past two decades, Canadian values have diverged in significant ways from those of Americans, despite the greater trade and investment links. So why in this difficult autumn for liberal economies, for societies, is economic populism in Canada conspicuously absent? Bob Wolf would probably say that thousands of PhDs have been written about this topic. But let me try, not having read on any of these PhDs on the matter. My hunch is that a lecture that your trade minister, Chrystia Freeland, delivered recently at the London School of Economics offers some instructive lessons about the Canadian exception. In a talk called Growing Trade the Progressive Way, Freeland first dwelt at length on the importance of reinforcing the purchasing power of middle classes. She then turned to a combination of secure borders and proudly multiculturalist policies that made Canada almost uniquely welcoming to immigrants. And it's only after that that she turned to the nitty-gritties of trade agreements. She talked about the steps that the government has taken to ensure that the agreement with the European Union does not limit the ability of the Canadian government to regulate in the public interest. And she talked about the importance of ensuring that businesses of all sizes are able to benefit from trade agreements, a point I'd like to come back to later. Because Canada has always had to balance its needs for access to the giant market next door with the demands of domestic politics, it probably gained a head start on other countries when it comes to thinking about how to balance trade deals with domestic priorities. Let me go back a bit in history, because history always teaches us lots of lessons. So I'm going to go back a little bit in Canadian history. I've had to study a little bit to prepare for the lecture, so I might as well use it now. In 1854, even before the Confederation, the Elgin-Marcy Treaty liberalized trade between British North America and the United States for a range of raw materials. In fact, Washington's unilateral termination of this treaty helped innovative politicians here to form the Dominion of Canada in 1867. After a decade of failed attempts to negotiate reciprocity with the US, Sir John Macdonald introduced the high tariff regime called the National Policy. And if you thought that in 1988 was the first Canadian election to turn on a trade agreement, think again. Wilfrid Laurier's Liberals were thrown out of power in 1911 when voters rejected his proposed mutual tariff-cutting treaty with Washington, fearing it would pave the way for annexation. The US remained Canada's biggest trading partner, of course, and the relationship with the US market preoccupied Canadian business and policy makers for decades and still does. In 1949, J. Douglas Gibson, for whom this lecture is named, edited a collection of essays of eminent Canadian economists, and he called this collection of essays Canada's Economy in a Changing World. Wow, a real visionary. Canada's relationship with the US was a major concern for contributors of this book. It was 1949. They proposed options that range from discriminatory tariffs against the US, which Gibson rightly said would violate the principles of the GATT, all the way to a free trade agreement, a customs union, and even a fully fledged political union. Lester Pearson once likened Canada's position alongside the US to, quote unquote, living with your wife. At times it is difficult to live with her. At all times it is impossible to live without her. And he was not kidding. In 2014, Canada's exports to the US alone amounted to about 20% of GDP. More and more countries can now understand what former Prime Minister meant. Trading partners have become connected, so connected that they cannot live without. And the tensions between external interests and domestic policies and domestic politics are intensifying. There are two big lessons that I think we can draw from this Canadian experience. Lesson number one, governments have choices about the kind of integration they want to pursue. They have choices. Lesson number two, within the choices they make, governments have considerable scope to pursue domestic policies. They should make the most of this space and use it to safeguard their key national priorities. These are the two lessons that I take from looking at the history of Canada. Canada has done so in pioneering ways. Back in 1950s, when fixed exchange rates were the norm, Canada chose to float its currency against the US dollar, giving itself greater monetary policy flexibility to cushion the effects of cross-border capital flows that it could not realistically, in reality, control. Floating exchange rates and unrestricted capital movements are standard practice today, but they were not when Canada adopted them. And let's be clear, nothing in Canada's trade obligations has prevented Canada from maintaining more progressive rates of income tax than the US, allowing Canada to fund somewhat larger basket of public services and goods that Canadian voters prefer. So there is a way, a national way to respond to globalization and its forces. Stagnating incomes for large sections of society in many advanced economies have given rise to growing unease, as people fear declining prospects for themselves and for their children. Much of this has little to do with trade. Ever since the first power looms did the job of weavers in the late 18th century, technology has increased productivity but threatened jobs for human. And we are today seeing probably an exacerbated version of this impact of technology in jobs. The only problem is that I'm still waiting to see the first referendum against technology, whereas I'm seeing a lot of referendums against trade. In the meantime, domestic policy decisions have cut taxes on the wealthy, have discouraged unionization, have exacerbated inequality, and have put downward pressures on wages, even in non-tradable sectors. Now, yes, technology has a big role to play, but trade also plays a role, and we have to recognize that. Even though some economists estimate that technology ate up to 4 jobs for everyone lost to trade, the factory jobs that lifted so many Vietnamese textile producers have also impacted on losses of jobs in textile mills in North Carolina. The fact is that during the heydays of globalization optimism in 1990 and the early 2000, political and business elites did not think enough about the distributional consequences of the trade agreements that they were signing. Probably an exception to this was my former boss, Pascal Lamy, who did concern about this question, who did write about this question. This happened even though trade theory clearly predicts that market opening will harm some people, even while leaving society as a whole much better off. Inclusivity is now firmly on the agenda. So if during the end of the 90s, beginning of the year 2000, we had forgotten about this inclusivity dimension, it's back on the agenda. And it's back on the agenda of Davos, and it's back on the agenda of the International Monetary Fund. And it demands action both at the level of international trade, but it also demands action at the domestic level. In international trade first, a big part of making trade more inclusive, whether in places like Canada or in developing countries, has to do with making sure that the benefits of trade reach more the small and medium enterprises. And I'm saying small and medium enterprises because they represent more than 90% of the economic tissue of any country, because they represent more than 70% of the jobs in any country, because they are a huge contributor to the wealth GDP of any country. So a more inclusive trade policy is a trade policy that pays more attention to helping, to supporting, also through trade policy, small and medium enterprises participate more in international trade. And when I say small and medium enterprises, I want to put next to it women in business, women-owned enterprises, because over 40% of these SMEs are in reality women-owned businesses. So the two dimensions of inclusivity, SMEs and women's economic empowerment, go hand in hand. It's important that when trade negotiators embark in negotiations, they understand the structure of these small and medium enterprises, of these women in business, that they understand it and that they factor this into their negotiating strategies. That they negotiate trade commitments and trade provisions that would support the inclusion of these actors in international trade, and that they monitor regularly after the agreement has been signed that they are indeed benefiting from the fruits of these international agreements. This is a big part of what the International Trade Center does, so you will forgive me for maybe trying to push a bit of our own agenda here. But we feel very comforted that our agenda is the agenda that everybody now is embracing as an inclusiveness agenda. Now let's look at the domestic side. To soothe protectionist anger in advanced economies, it is probably in this front that we need much more action. As we have seen, technology, policy, and to a lesser extent, trade are all contributing to job and income insecurity. Governments need to respond across the board to address the disruption and the distributional effects, the two, the disruption and the distributional effects. Much of what is needed is probably investments in human capital, in education, in skills building, in vocational training, to better match people with job opportunities, and not necessarily to match them with the job opportunities today, but to think of the job opportunities of tomorrow and the day after tomorrow. This area will be key to support citizens to cope with the impact of trade opening, but more importantly, with the impact of technology in our economies and in our societies. Active labor market policies will need to be coupled with measures to soften the blow of unemployment, including, why not, exploring universal basic incomes, like a number of countries are doing here in Canada, in Finland, or even in the city of Utrecht in the Netherlands. Income-related policies such as wage, insurance, higher minimum wages, and wage top-ups are other options that will need to be considered. Innovation policies and investment in research and development will be key to invest in the economy of tomorrow. Taxes may need to go up. And while we are on taxes, maybe a bit more international cooperation to curb corporate tax avoidance may help governments in raising more taxes. All of this points to the need to better synchronize domestic policies with trade policies. In reality, the program is one of improving the competitiveness of the economies and the social progress of societies. That is the challenge that we have ahead of us. In short, governments need to be prepared to spend money to keep citizens on board with globalization. And they need to spend it intelligently to help citizens progress with globalization. Political honesty of this kind is today pretty brave. And more of it is needed to reinforce the increasingly fragile social license on which open markets rest today. Leaders need to be upfront with electorates. Trade, like technology, is good for most people, but not for everybody. So more market opening needs to come with more redistributive social policies. A retreat behind protectionist barriers cannot bring back the manufacturing jobs in any meaningful way. In rich countries, it would hurt purchasing power of the poorest consumers. And in developing countries, it would derail growth and poverty reduction strategies. So in sum, the proposal I have for you tonight is first that globalization is worth saving, that the future of globalization is likely to be less about wide and more about deep, and that pro-inclusion trade policies, more redistribution, better leveraging of technological change, more dialogue and political honesty could help save that type of globalization. And if you think that this agenda is unrealistic, or if you think that this agenda is too expensive, well, just think of the cost of a backlash. Thank you very much for your attention and for having invited me to deliver the Gibson Lecture 2016. Thank you.